You want to talk to
him? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what
you
want.
Yeah, just give me 1 second there.
It's like a bit of deja vu, doesn't it? Whoever would like to get started?
Yep.
Yeah. Where were you in the pitch of day? What was your POV?
I don't know where I was. I'd have to watch this back and see where I ended up. What a fantastic evening for the Central Coast, for this football club, for the supporters, for everybody who's connected to it. It's an amazing achievement, and those players just don't know when to give in.
Did you think they might have finally run out of gas?
No.
You obviously know that's sitting there in them, and they brought it out.
I honestly, people ask me that, and they say it's easy to say that now when you score, but I honestly believe we were going to score. I did. I believe we were going to score, and when it went to extra time, I knew the boys could go to another level as well. So it's easy to say that after the event, but that those were my beliefs on the touchline.
Jacob, this is the 8th time Victor has shipped a goal after the 85th minute to fall out of a winning position. Did you see something on the film analysis that you figured you could exploit in those moments?
No, not really. We knew how we wanted to play, but it wasn't anything like that. I just know that this group has got tremendous will to keep going right until the end. So I always had confidence in us having the ability to create a chance, and then we needed that little bit of quality to put into the back of the net, and that's what we got.
How did you turn the game around?
Well, when we conceded the goal, we had to make the changes to go for it a little bit. And I've said before that I've got full belief in all the players in the squad. Those who don't actually start the game, I've got full belief in every one of them who can come on and affect the game. I think our understanding as a whole squad now of how we want to play and what we need to do in certain situations has grown even further. So, it's not just a starting 11 who know what we want to execute. It's a whole squad. So that's credit to the staff for teaching the players. It's credit to the players for taking on board the information and understanding what's needed at what time. So when I realise I have that, I can make substitutions to affect the game, and that's what we did today.
There's no doubt this is a collective. We all know about this club and how special it is. But just for you personally, I mean, they say the hardest thing in management is to follow on from a successful coach. You've now done that after a rocky start and won the treble. I mean, how proud are you of what you've been able to achieve?
Yeah, I'm pleased, obviously. A big factor in that is Danny Schofield. Massive factor in that is Danny. Me and him worked really closely together in the off-season when we were both out of work. We were scouting games, we were talking about football, we were talking about potential opportunities. We were working on our football philosophy together, and then when this opportunity came, he was courageous enough to step on a plane and come with me, because it takes a lot to do that. He's been without his family now for a while. They're due to come over in July, so that'll be fantastic for him. But I'm made up for him as well, because without him, this doesn't happen for me. Yeah, and again, he's a player I brought in, so everybody thinks that player comes in, he's going to be a starter, but that's not how we work. I see things from the strikers and how they can affect certain games, and I'm confident that when he doesn't start, he'll come on and make an impact, and he did that. But I've had a relationship with Ryan now for a fair few years. I had him as a 16-year-old at Leeds, and he came through, and believe it or not, he was still the same size when he was 16. But he showed the quality tonight. But it wasn't just about one player. It's not about one player. That definitely not. It's about the whole team collective, and he got the headlines with a goal. But yeah, can't underestimate what the team did tonight. It was phenomenal.
I know you say it's about the team, but Ryan has just won the Joe Marsden medal. So just like when you were looking to bring him out, did you have to twist his arm? Was he ready to jump at the opportunity? How did that all go about?
No, it was a conversation. I knew that we needed a little bit more firepower early on in the season. And I know he's only 22 years old. He's only a young player in that respect. And I know he's got a lot of growth in him. And that's kind of the players we want to go after, people who can develop and get better and be successful for the club and, you know, maybe bring the club some money in further down the line. That's what we have to do here. So I knew he would fit the bill, and he was keen to come straight away. He showed courage as well, getting on a plane to come across, and you know, he showed faith in me and Danny that we were kind of tasked with, you know, getting him back on track, and you know, he's starting to do that. He's got a long way to go, and we'll continue to do that with all the players. Development. Yeah, he was all over the place tonight at the end. He never stopped running. What an athlete. You know, all the players in the team, and Nizzy's one of them, we want them to play at the highest level they can, of course we do. We'd love him to still be here with us. And I need a conversation with him.
Mark, just asked this to Ryan before, but when you speak to people back in England and you talk about this club, football in the A-League, tonight, what do you say to them, to football fans there and people you're connected to?
Well, I think they can see it as well. And I said to Popper before the game, I hope it's a fantastic game tonight. And I thought it was a great game. It's two teams who deserve to be in the grand final. And I wanted to put on a show for the A-League. And I think both teams did that, and credit to Melbourne. They were really resolute tonight. They played good football. They've got some great players. They really, really tested us, pushed us right into the end. So I think it's a great advert for the league. I think the supporters back home for me, a lot of people watch these games, and you know, I'm saying that, listen, this is a really, really competitive league, and it's got some fantastic players, and you know, I've been managed to be part of a team who've just gone and achieved what they've achieved this evening. So, you know, super proud, and you know, my family back home are really proud of what I've achieved as well.
What do your next few days look like, do you think,
Mark? we'll celebrate tonight. I've got a lot of planning to do. I'm back on a plane to England on Wednesday. I've got to graduate for the pro license on Wednesday, so I'm back on a plane to England I've got a 5-day last module for that, where I've got to pull together two presentations and present them. So at some point I'm going to have to do them, but I've got a little bit to write about on that anyway. We'll celebrate it. We've got a lot of planning to do, myself, Simo, Rich. We've got a lot of planning to do. This is a busy time for managers now. Players get the chance to rest. But I've got a little bit of work to do. But I will take time to. What I want to do with my family when I get back over here is explore Australia a little bit, and because I haven't been able to do that in the time I've kind of. Been here, there, and everywhere, but never really seen anywhere properly. So we're going to explore the Central Coast and a little bit further afield as well.
In terms of planning, like we sort of alluded to it before with Nizzy, not sure what he's going to do next season. Like, it seems probable that there'll be a bit of turnover in your squad, as there was last time. And I think we've all learned our lessons and not expect the Mariners to simply drop down because of that turnover. What is so good about the platform that this club is going to give you when you do go through that plan? Because it looks like the Mariners have done this a couple of times now, and it seems to, you know, whatever you're working off, it works well.
Yeah, and you know, they had kind of certain ways of working in place, and you know, to get the players in. And what I've tried to do when coming here is add different processes in that as well, tweak things in certain ways, how I think things should be dealt with and worked. And you know, the club fully buy into that. They give me license to do that and put my ideas to the table, because. You know, I've created quite a bit of experience over the years where I've worked and who I've worked with, and you know, I've got my own ideas how things should be run, and you know, I'm privileged that the club want to do that and want to roll with it. So, yeah, those processes are in place now, and we're starting to action them. And you know, yeah, the potentially players going out, but we've already got our eyes on players coming in as well. So, you know, I think players will see that they'll want to come here. They can come here and develop and get better. And be part of something special. Listen, there's no doubt it's going to be tough. Of course there is, when you have that kind of turnover. But yeah, if we stick to those processes and get them right and develop them and tweak them a little bit, then we'll be okay.
Matt, obviously so much is talked about the community here at Gosford. I mean, we got a first-hand look at not only the pitch invasion, but it was a pitch invasion of a record crowd as well. Since your arrival, what have you made of what the Mariners mean to this community and this community means to the Mariners?
Yeah, and that's one thing I've tried to do since I've come here. It's really important to me as a person that when I ever go to a club, I try and understand what the club's about. I knew it was a community club. I wanted to get to know the history of the club, and I've spent a lot of time speaking to people, getting to know people, listening to what they had to say about the club, and understanding what the club is. So, you know, I think I've got an idea of that now. That's not my music choice, by the way. A bit of 80s R&B or a bit of smooth FM. But anyway, for me. But I think I'm getting to understand what the club the club is about and the community is about. And I think this week has taught me even more about what this club means to the community and what the community means to the club as well. It really is one place and one special place to be. And I want to build on that relationship. We want to be trying to sell out this stadium as many times as we can and get as many supporters into the stadium as we can in the future, and we can do that by being successful and connecting with the community, and that's part of my job as well.
Mark, I don't know how much you know about the history of the A-League, but I mean, this victory tonight and claiming the treble will almost certainly basically start a debate about whether this team is the greatest team in A-League history. I mean, do you have a sort of stance on that? Do you reckon your boys are the best team this league's ever seen?
I don't know the history that much, so all I can say is that this is a special group of players. And staff and club at this particular point. They're a special bunch, really, really are, and I can't praise them enough. They have to cross the white line. I'm here to pick teams and nudge it in the right direction. All the staff are here to help work with them on an individual basis and collective basis, but listen, those players cross the white line and they have to fight, they have to execute things, and they've done that this season, time after time after time, so I'll let people make their own assumptions of what kind of team we are, but, you know, I know what team we are, and it's a special team.
Jeff, I just want to Michael, you want to go out and celebrate with it, but Gilda Pizzio, 18 years old, it's not the first time he's come on and helped turn a game sort of off the bench second half. What's he got that you're obviously so enamoured with and are confident to throw in a kid of his tender age into a game like that?
Yeah, no, listen, it was close to starting as well. We've got fantastic trust in his ability. I challenged him a fair few weeks ago now to be better in duels and stronger, just to use his body. He's still a young boy and he's still going into his body. But I said, I want you to be stronger and I want you to win more duels. What did he do? Next day in training, started doing that and actioning it. So that tells me I've got a young man there who wants to listen, learn and action what we want. So he's done that and he's gone from strength to strength, and he's gone on the pitch today and really impacted the game.
Matt, we've been asking you about all the stuff that you've had to do from a football perspective since you've arrived here, but personally, you up sticks and moved to the other side of the world on pretty short notice. Personally, has this been a difficult year for you to just adjust and in your own personal life?
It was tough, like I said, not for me jumping on a plane, but me jumping on a plane and leaving my family. It was really difficult for them. Difficult for me in the first couple of months as well, but you know, there were me and Danny living together, and we just immersed ourselves in the game and the club, and we knew we had to do that, so it actually worked quite well. And they come out in January, and you know, I thank them every day for what they've done and what they sacrificed. It's a journey for them, it's an adventure for them as well. We've left family behind back in England, but everybody has been so supportive. So my immediate family here, but my family back home in England, I thank them for what they've done to help me get this opportunity and to take this chance.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you
so much.
Thanks, Mark.
Thanks, Jack.
Cheers, thank you. Hope you've enjoyed the season as well.
Yeah.